Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I think it's still morning. I'm what's standing between you and lunch, so I'll plow right through this. So my name is Robert Brunner. I'm an industrial designer. I spend most of my time in the world of hardware, some hardware and software, but really about creating new things and bringing them out into the world. So I'm going to talk to you today about that, of what it means. I actually have my own studio in San Francisco by the name of Ammunition. We're a design development company, and Beats is one of our main things. I helped start the company, nearly 16 years ago. So I've been doing that, and I will talk about it as well. But the main topic of my conversation today with you is there's nothing on the screen. So can we get the display up, please? There we go. About making great stuff, right? So what is it, you know, what are the things, what does it take to get a product in this space from good to great? And I'm gonna start out with a question. And it's a question that we ask ourselves on nearly every project that we do. And that's this. All right, well, what's worth designing in the first place? And for some reason, these transitions are not going, but that's okay. So this, you know, when we start a project, one of the most important things that we do is ask ourselves this question. Because when you're creating a product, a hardware product, you know, it takes an enormous amount of effort, enormous amount of human effort, enormous amount of natural resources, enormous amount of capital, usually anywhere between $5 to $50 million or more. So it's very important that you understand, right, what's worth doing in the first place. And we build this framework, we don't limit ourselves, but really sort of gain an understanding of what's important, what's the opportunity, who are we gonna reach, how are we gonna reach them, everything like that. So I'm gonna talk a little bit over this, you know, so my transitions for some reason are not going, so I have to do this manually, which is a little nerve-wracking. So, you know, what's worth designing? You know, something relevant. Something that makes sense in people's lives and the world at large and fulfills a need that people have. It fits well in the context of their world and in time and place. It's something that people need and want. Something that is unique and meaningfully so, not just simply differentiated per se, but rather has its own purpose, integrity, and energy that stands out. It has its own character that defines how it looks, behaves, and operates. It's something that's considered, right? That has been thought out thoroughly. It has a editorial viewpoint that is discernible. It has been deeply developed, vetted, and delivered in the best possible form. Something that is in fact desirable. It's more than just usable and useful. People need to want and feel compelled to have it in their lives. It should have positive emotional value and communicate to the heart. And it should be coveted. And as I mentioned, something that's resource worthy. It takes an enormous amount of fiscal capital, as I said, human capital, everything to bring something out into the world. It needs to be something worthy of this. It should not be a waste. And it should generate value. At some level, the opportunity needs to, of course, create economic value. It should be viewed not just as a thing, but as a service too. And it should be capable of generating a value all along a chain of events. And it should be transformative. It should be a gateway to more than the object itself. It should take people to a better place and be part of an amazing journey. It should make people feel good about who they are and expand upon it in ways big and small. So these are some of the things, again, that we've developed in our studio. And since my timing was off, I'm really behind here, but I'll continue to go through it. And so we work in a lot of areas, but most of it tends to be consumer technology, in which we're developing something new and bringing it out into the world. Many times it hasn't been done before. Highly digital, a few analog things here and there, but really about sort of creating an experience that people can relate to in both a physical and, of course, in a software sense as well. So, all right, now that I made it through that part manually, it'll be a little easier. Another question. And this is something I've thought about a lot. You know, I work on a lot of projects and they almost always turn out good, right? Every once in a while, you get involved in something that turns out to be great, right? So why does that happen? What are the differences in getting from good to great? So let's look at good, right? Good, you know, in many ways, good is about being usable, right? People can figure out how to use it. It's useful. You know, I can do something that's important in my lives, and it's desirable. I want it to be part of my lives, right? It's attractive. It's functional. It's competitive from a business point of view. It's manufacturable. It's attainable for people, right? And to get there, you know, you need to understand the opportunity, right? You need to have the talent to be able to design it well. You need to have the tools and process and experience, right, to make sure that it comes out well, right? These are all the things that make something good. But great's a different deal entirely, right? Great moves the needle. When you do something great, it's inspiring, it's empowering, and it's transformative. It challenges norms, it becomes culturally relevant, and in many ways is a portal to something bigger than the thing itself. It's socially positive and creates change and develops high value in the world. And to get there, it's an entirely different level of thinking, right? It's having a worldview and understanding the context of what you're doing in that worldview. It's having true empathy for your audience and not just understanding what their lives are like and their needs are and understanding that. That's important, but also figuring out how to build a relationship with them and to communicate with them. It's having a clarity and vision. It's really being able to see what this thing needs to be and then having the commitment and the tenacity to get there. And all along through this, there's this phrase I really like called fluid intelligence. Those of you that have developed product know that you constantly run into new things to have to deal with and learn and understand. So your fluidity of moving through that system and staying at a high level is really important. So it's almost always about a form of leadership, right? As I said, all the things that I've looked at that have been great, there has always been a small number or maybe even one person that's maniacally insane about getting this thing just right. And to me, that's the viewpoint that we try and embody as much as possible in almost everything we do. So I'm going to talk a little bit about three things that great leaders know, right? So I'm going to look at a couple of projects and people that we've worked with and really talk about what are some of the things that are very important in this. So the first, this is really important. I think a lot of people in this audience will understand and resonate with this. It's about technology. And of course, technology enables. It enables fantastic capability. It opens doors. It allows new ways of thinking, new ways of doing things. It's the core of doing something really great. But what I found time and time again, and people that really know about bringing something new in the world understand that the design is what establishes in people's lives. Effectively, you can have an amazing technology, right? You can do something that have something you have that no one else has that creates an entirely new world. But it does not matter. It does not matter if nobody gets it, if nobody needs it, or nobody wants it, right? It'll fail, and you see that time and time again. So the way that you deliver that, right, the way that you deliver that out into the world becomes almost as or even sometimes more important than the core technology itself. So the first example we worked with, so this is Jack Dorsey in his clean cut days when he first started Square. We started working with Square and worked on the second generation of the reader for the iPhone. The first one was functional, but had a lot of issues. So we redesigned it, helped get it working right. And then we were given this really amazing assignment. And that was the Square Stand, which became known as the Square Stand. And really what we were trying to do was redefine the cash register. And what was amazing about what Jack and his team had created was it really had, you know, for at the point in time where it democratized credit card usage, right? It used to be a pain in the ass to use credit cards. Now, if you were selling sneakers on the street, you could take Visa, MasterCard, American Express. So moving into the small business, the idea was how do we take that and build upon that technology and create a new system that would allow people to be much more effective in managing and running their business. But do it in a way, do it in a form that was compelling, that created pride and ownership, and did the job really well. So this was a square sand. And when we did the first product, there's this really interesting aspect of the square meter where, you know, you would give the vendor your credit card, you'd swipe it, then return the phone to you and do your signature. And there was this really wonderful exchange that we felt that was important. So we introduced this amazing piece of technology, which was called the Lazy Susan. So essentially, we just put a little swivel on the bottom and it allowed you to have that transaction, right? And it was a very simple thing, but it became an important part of the experience and something that really, again, helped maintain this connection between the retailer and the customer. And this is one of those products, sometimes you do these where the back becomes the most important view. And so we really, really finessed and worked it to just make it feel just right, just perfect, beautiful, minimal, but having a presence. And again, it became a point of pride for retailers to use. So it's not about what enables it. It's about how it's accessed and understood and the value and benefit that it can provide. Otherwise, you won't, you'll fail. So the second point is something that's near and dear to my heart, but often gets overlooked. And that's the notion of craftsmanship and the fact that craftsmanship really matters, right? You should care about the quality of everything you do, especially the things that go out into the world that define your company, define your experience, define your product. It's incredibly important, right? So this is another entrepreneur we worked with, a company called Terra Cafe, Sahin Domani, and someone is a coffee fanatic. He is all about brewing the perfect coffee and developing machines that can do that in an automated way. But it's all about the quality, all about getting it just right and giving people tools to make an amazing cup of coffee every day. So we got involved with Terra Cafe to do their second generation machine. This is it, this is the TKO2. And it's a very sophisticated, high-end espresso machine. But it, again, highly automated, high quality control. And when we developed it, we thought we wanted to take that craftsmanship that he was so passionate with about making the coffee into the device. So everything about this project was about refinement and execution and getting it just right. So all the details, all the controls, even the interface, right? It has this very simple, beautiful, easy to understand, and occasionally a little quirky interface. It was very engaging and brought you into the process of using the machine. And so this product has launched. It's just now shipping out into the field, and it's really an amazing machine. So building great products requires an almost maniacal commitment to quality and excellence. And the love and the care of the creator should be apparent. And I ask you this, how many times when you feel that, right? When you have a product and you can really tell that someone cared about making it just right, right? That creates a relationship between you and the product, you and the brand, you and the creators. So having that care for the craftsmanship and the quality of what you do is incredibly important. So the final one, right? So it's the idea, not the object. So I spend the vast majority of my time crafting objects. I love it, that's what I do. Making things beautiful, making them perfect, making them easy to understand and use. But what I see is that really the very successful things are not necessarily about the object. Of course, the object has to be great, but they're based on an idea, not just their form and function. And it's an idea that can be understood, an idea that can be extended, an idea that can be built on. I often, when I lecture to students, say, take out your iPhone, you know, take away the logo, take away iOS, take away the packaging, take away everything about it other than the thing itself. Is it still an iPhone? No, it's not, right? Because it's all those things and it's based on an idea. So this, of course, is about Beats by Dr. Dre. We'll be right back. So that was the first commercial we ever did, which was paid for by Best Buy. So this is Jimmy Iovine and, of course, Dr. Dre. I met them almost 19 years ago and started working with them on this idea of building audio products. And it was really interesting because I had this really sort of surreal feeling because we actually worked really well together and connected. And I couldn't figure out because I was this, you know, Silicon Valley design nerd. And this is, you know, Dr. Dre and Jimmy Iovine, arguably the greatest producer and music promoter of all times. And what I came to figure out was what they saw me as an artist and they see themselves as an artist. And we had that connection and we built on it and actually built an amazing business out of it. But what Beats was about was really around three basic ideas, right? From Dre's perspective, and I remember he said this in the first meeting that we had, people are not hearing my music. And what he meant by that is, you know, he had defined a genre and he would spend an enormous amount of time crafting his songs in the studio, sometimes like a year on a single song. And it would go out and what he said through, and people would listen to it in quote unquote crappy white earbuds. I remember that. It was ironic the crappy white earbud company bought them. But you know, it was really about, there weren't even the high-end products were out there with a sound profile that could support his music. My perspective was that headphones are wearable technology. They're worn on the body, right? They should be designed as such, but that wasn't what was occurring. And Jimmy's point of view was, make the headphone the star. In the same way that he'd built a career of so many musicians and drove them to incredibly high levels of popularity, he wanted to do the same thing with the headphone. So from the headphone point of view, I actually, you know, had these one of these really simple epiphanies about headphones. When you look at them, you know, headphones are really hard to design, right? There's a lot of things that go into, a lot of functional needs. Of course, acoustics, comfort, reliability, adjustability, all these things are driving to, you end up with these mechanisms on your head. And I remember printing out a picture like this and drawing a single line that ran from ear to ear and thought, wouldn't it be great if I could just get rid of all that stuff and make it clean, right? And actually make it look good on the body. And that was the first studio. And the other thing that we did that I kind of think no one else had ever done was actually design them on the body, right? We would constantly, you know, either virtual and reality, put them on heads and figure out what it looks like and really defining this aesthetic. Because what ultimately we wanted to do was create something that people felt good wearing and felt good out in the world, in addition to having this amazing audio capability. So that began to develop an entire line of products. Of course, the first studio, we did the Solo, which became an amazingly successful product. The Pro, which was a higher end passive headphone. The Mixer was our DJ headphone, you know, sort of taking this idea and this aesthetic and building out into in-ear products, speakers, portable Bluetooth speakers. And then we got to the second generation, right? And we took this even further. We used some more advanced servicing techniques, really streamlined design, made it even closer to the head. And that's when the second generation studio was born, which has been in the market for 10 years and still typically is the number one or number two selling over ear headphone in the world. And built that out into an entire line of the next generation Solo. And then we decided, okay, there's this connection between music and athletics, right? And to people when they're working out or practicing, like to listen to their favorite playlist. So we worked with LeBron James on developing the Power Beats, which was all about sort of creating a stable connection to your body while you're in movement. And we got to another generation of the Solo where we really moved the mechanical approach to our headphones to a new level. This is an incredibly sophisticated, beautiful product that just, again, performed really well, looked fantastic on the body. And then we get to this product. So this is about just after the acquisition occurred, and we're doing a true wireless Power Beats athletics headphone. And what we now had access, in addition to an entire technology portfolio, was an enormous amount of data about ear design. Now, if any of you have ever worked on an earbud, you'll know that it's, again, one of the more complicated things to design. Just by the fact that everybody's ears are different, and every person side to side, their ears are different, and not just in a couple ways, in about seven different directions of dimensions and angles. So how do you create a single product that's gonna fit 80% of the world? Very challenging. So having that data really helped us. And what we ended up doing was, the other thing about in-ear products is the acoustics are heavily tied to the way they seal in your ear canal. So if they're gonna be moving, they're not gonna work as well. So again, it was all about stabilization. What I love about that clip is the core idea. You can see it, just stability is everything, right? And maintaining that through the shape of the headphone in your ear canal and the ear hook, and being able to meet a wide number of sizes and do that effectively is actually an incredible task. So that we continue, this is actually one of my favorite products. This is Beats Flex. And I love things like this because we designed it based from a cost point of view, and to make it lower cost, we moved the battery and the radio outside of the earbud, but we put them into the cord. And what it actually created was this, I wear these all the time because you have this, again, wearable piece of technology. It's on your body when you need it. You put it in, you can make a call, listen to music, et cetera. True wireless and the studio, Beats Studio Buds. And this is another really intense ergonomic exercise, which was developing a wingtip based, again, for stability, but again, one size fits all. So the amount of prototyping and testing to achieve that was incredible, but it actually is extremely effective across 75 to 80% of the population. So lastly, I'm gonna talk about Jimmy. So Jimmy is brilliant and one of the most passionate, enigmatic people I've ever worked with. And really, again, had this idea of for his audience, an audience to rock and popular music, there was no high performance headphone audio brand. So let's go do that, right? So, what he did was, what he really understood, this is very important, was this sort of idea of popular culture. What popular culture, what happens there is where art and commerce meet, right? It's where you can focus on the art and the artist, and really connect that with commerce and create something that's basically akin to pouring gasoline on a fire. So, every opportunity to expose the brand, one of my favorite Jimmy quotes was, I asked him early on what his marketing strategy is, and he says, "Robert, my marketing strategy is a lot of people owe me a lot of favors." And so every opportunity to get the headphone, almost every video that went out of Universal Music, every friend, athlete, performer that he knew, right, was seen with the headphone and began to create this contextual, cultural awareness of the product and sort of set it at a higher level. And then, we began collaborating with artists, Lady Gaga on some in-ear products, Lil Wayne on colorways, Nicki Minaj, Pharrell Williams, of course, LeBron, Serena Williams, Colin Kaepernick, Neymar. And so what it really did was sort of elevate this thing at a level. So when you left your house with your headphones around your neck, you felt a connection to these people. And really it was transformative in that way. So again, it's the idea, really. It's really to focus on what that is. What is the core idea? How will it change things? Understanding what it is you're really delivering, right? Are you delivering audio performance, or are you delivering a connection into culture, or both, right? How does it fit into culture? And what about it really matters? Those are very important questions to ask when you're developing a product. So this is how I knew we were getting somewhere. This is about a year after the studio launch, and I found this on the Beats Facebook page. And it's kind of like, you know, you're in a different territory when people start tattooing their product on your bodies. You're like in Harley Davidson territory. I contend that this woman probably regrets that tattoo today, but it was an indicator, okay, we're doing something here. So back to this question, right? What's worth designing in the first place? Of course, it's something great. So last, I'm gonna wrap up here with a few notes on achieving greatness, right? It's really important to know your mission, right? Know what you're after, have some clarity on that, but also the non-negotiable boundaries, right? It's very important that you understand the boundary conditions that you cannot cross to maintain that mission and stay away from them. Understand your audience, and I said, not just who they are, what they do, what they need, but build a relationship. Look at how you communicate through your product, through your service, through your communications, and build that relationship. Create a team culture that embraces challenge, right? So many times as building a team, we're focused, of course, on capability, ability to meet deadlines, ability to have a certain level. But really what you want is someone a team that says, okay, we're gonna stretch, and this is something we want to embrace, right? Build cultural awareness of what you're really delivering. Be design religious. You know, it has to be through a relentlessness of that idea and showing up in the world in the way you want it to be. And then managing compromise. There's this phrase I love, the death of a thousand cuts. And as you move anything through the process of development, you make all these micro compromises. And what happens when you get to the end is it doesn't look like what you started with, right? Because you've basically taken all these little bites out of it. So it's very important to manage that and understand those boundaries around what you need to do to maintain the integrity of something. And finally, I say to you all, enjoy the ride. I mean, really, this, to be doing what you're doing and to be developing things and bring them out into the world and potentially changing people's lives in a positive way is truly a privilege. So always understand that, no matter how fucking hard it gets, enjoy the ride because it's amazing. And that's what I have today. Thank you very much.